This conference will now be recorded.
Morning, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yeah, Anshu, I think Idayat has to log in. So he would be logging, I think, in another 5-10 minutes.
Yep. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. I'll go on mute for 5-10 minutes. Then you can type on chat when he joins in. So you're saying we'll just wait for some time?
Yeah, you can probably wait till he logs in. It might take 5 minutes more. So once he's joined, I think I'll start the session.
Okay, so just type on the chat. I will be on mute and I will check back in at 5:45.
Sure.
So what will be your time, I think? 10:15, I guess, by that
yep.
time. All right, I'll be on mute.
Hello.
Shoot my audio. Having some problem.
I can hear you there.
Now you can hear me. I cannot hear anything, but.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, but I cannot hear Anshu's voice.
Yeah.
I don't know what's happening. You can hear me, right? But
yes, Anshu yes, talking? I can hear you. Are you there?
He's on mute. So is Anshu talking now? Or because no, I cannot hear him?
He should start that he would be starting another 5 minutes.
Okay, no problem. I was thinking there is some problem with my voice.
No, everything is clear.
Okay, good. Okay, thank you. Okay. Leon.
Hi everyone, can you hear me?
Nice, Anshu.
A lot of nights.
All right, so Shahid, Arif, and Jalaluddin. Hidayat, right, sorry. Let me verify the audio. And you can see my screen as well.
So you have to share your screen. Your screen is not visible.
One second. It should show up now. Let's see. Yes, now yes, I think you can
see. Yeah, it's visible now.
Okay, perfect. So I will add some additional slides here so that we can work for the training as well. Okay, yeah, this is good enough.
Your screen is still not, again, not visible.
I think it works slightly differently when I share the app versus I share the document. It behaves a little differently. Okay, but still. All right, so morning everyone. I am Anshu Singare and I am into the general industry, working industry for more than 20 years. And I have worked in many places, played many roles. Finally, from almost last 10 years, I am an enterprise architect where I help businesses to understand and implement their enterprise architecture within the organization. Now we will understand what does it really mean, but before that, let me ask each of you also to introduce yourselves. So let us see. Arif can start. And we'll put it on the screen as well. If you can see, I'm writing. Arif, can you hear me? If we cannot hear you, if you have any problem with your mic,
yeah, you can type. Arif has problems with his mic. You can call him on his mobile.
Okay, so while we speak to others, what I would like you to tell me is your name, what are you doing right now, for how long, and what do you expect out of this training. So we will just hear from each of you, although I have spoken to some of you before, but so for the training itself, during the training, let us go through this. So Arif, I think we just heard you. Was that your voice?
Arif?
No. Arif is having some issue with the.
Okay, so that was not his voice.
So yeah, his voice. It was his voice, and he came and just left.
Yeah, I thought it was his voice.
Hello.
He's there now.
Yeah. Okay. Can hear you.
Okay. So I was connected, but somehow I don't know. I could hear your voice. Anyways, my name is Arif, and I've been in IT industry for almost 20 years now, working into SAP, played different roles, now finally working as an enterprise solution architect, and you know, doing that. So continuing with TOGAF, so it will help us to you know, expand our role in enterprise architecture.
Sure. So are you aware of TOGAF a little bit, Arif?
Yes.
And do you utilize it somewhere, or it's just that you are aware what the name is and who is the publisher? And
Not yet. Yeah, we were working on the app patterns and we're discussing and you know, working on that. So nothing much. We just started that role, and I was playing as an SAP solution architect before this, applying, you know, solutions and on that sort of thing. But playing an enterprise architecture, this is the first time, and working on the app patterns. But yeah, so that way.
Okay, and what do you expect?
I don't know. I mean, TOGAF will help us in you know, future app patterns and building, understanding the enterprise architecture more. I think making use of TOGAF into the enterprise architecture, that's our goal, and that's the expectation, that we can use all these framework into our role. Okay.
All right. Okay. Thank you, Arif. Who's next? Hidayat.
Yeah. Hidayatullah here, and I've been into IT for 26 years, and then I've been into SAP almost like 21 years.
Years now.
Yeah, and I've done various sorts of roles. Like I'm basically a programmer who started my career as a programmer. Then moved on to SAP functional analyst, and I've been doing SAP functional for the last 21 years. And I actually want to do TOGAF because I have to get into the architecture, and I know there is an it's open standard, open group, or whatever they call it. It's a TOGAF. That's just a basic information. I know I don't have any further entire details of anything TOGAF and what is it. All that I know, it's being used for an architecturing one for the for the companies, for the enterprise. And and I also heard the very first point I was trying to get into TOGAF like 2014 was I heard that all the other like PMP pro, you know, prints to everything, there are millions of people certified on the globe, but I heard that time it was only 38,000 or certified people around the globe. Now it could be some 54. I don't know. This is what I understood long time back. So there are very, very less people certified when you compare with any other things. This is another thing which interested me to get into this so that we might get some opportunity and there's a good demand for it. This is all from my end. I might be wrong with the numbers. I don't know that 50,000 or whatever it is. This is what I heard. Maybe you might be knowing better than me. Yeah.
Yeah, that number keeps changing. So, but yeah, that is interesting that when you compare with many other certifications, then that number is quite different and less.
Yes, yes. The reason why I was saying that, see, when we look for job or something, and many places they ask me, do you have TOGAF, TOGAF in back in 2014? I didn't have TOGAF. Right. And the reason I felt if I had a TOGAF, I would have got a lot of jobs. But I was without job for a quite substantial time, you know, with like 10 months I've been without job. But everywhere when I was looking at, there are a lot of opportunities for TOGAF. That is another motivation point for me. But anyway, now years passed. Now I'm finally getting into it to learn. That's my end.
Right. And when you have something stable going on, probably it is easier to learn.
Yep. Yep.
Because you don't have to worry about.
Yeah, yeah, but that I'm not at the moment. At this stage, I want to learn the subject, become the master of the subject. I'm not keen on getting job or anything, you know, at this stage.
Correct.
It's not for me the job. I'm not towards a job target for this, you know, like the same way I've done some of other certifications. Still I've not got a job or anything, but I want to understand the concepts and, you know,
right.
So whenever an opportunity comes, I can get into it. That's all.
Right. So I was just narrating your parts of the story on the screen, but what I've written with this hyphen is what you expect.
Yes.
Right. So understand enterprise architecture. All right. And finally, Shahid.
Hi. In the IT industry from 95, probably 23 years into various roles. The biggest role I have is into SAP basis, where I can consider myself as a platform guy and very good understanding of databases, operating systems, networks, and since 2 years, we've been doing some architecture work without our knowledge that this is architecture work, without knowing that, you know, the actual architecture language that, you know, then somebody pointed out that, you know, I and Arif are doing the architecture work and why don't you guys get into the enterprise level architecture? Then we saw the grass is greener the other side when we got into the enterprise level architecture. Things are like, you know, yeah, there are a lot of things which we don't know. I especially try to you know, read out, like, you know, I can understand the entire architecture diagram, whether it is like, you know, conceptual or is it like, you know, waterfall, these and that. I can understand where things belongs where, but the only problem with me is that, you know, the names of, especially in architecture, there are names. For
terminology.
Example, yeah, terminology. For example, like, you know, we say, can you please prepare a cut-over plan? Then we prepare a cut-over plan. And in architecture, it's called artifact. In the regular basis, probably Arif or Hidayah prepare a document and then submit, you know, how to deal with this one that is called artifact. And probably I might have prepared a document which the problem is like, you know, keep on occurring and how to solve this problem in the future and apply this solution across the landscape is called nothing but a pattern, you know. So right. Yeah, so you have an idea, like, you know, yeah, for example, you know, backup restore is like, you know, you can create a pattern backup and restore, and an idea how to do the Armand backup, how to do the BR tool using BR tool or using Commvault, these and that. You can create a document and then, you know, you can give it to the customer and he can use that document to configure the other systems, but we don't know that that is called pattern in architecture.
Correct.
And building blocks and these and that. So I'm trying, what you have is a raw experience at the ground. For example, like, you know, it's kind of a experience of a soldier and the experience of a guy who's sitting in the office giving the commands, two different things. You know, the soldier knows more on the ground, that's my belief,
right,
than the by guy experience. Who was, yeah, by experience, like, you know, what's the atmosphere, like, you know, how is the enemy doing on the ground, even that.
Yes.
So we the guys, even the developers, the administrators, knows the ground. Sometimes what I feel is that, you know, the architecture guys sitting on the top and they just draw a diagram. They say, oh, we can integrate this with this one, this with this one, and this is a security, this thing, this thing, this thing. And then when it comes to reality, what's happening is, like, you know, that those things doesn't work. They don't talk to the they don't talk to the actual guy who is actually involved in the integration or implementation or, you know, doing things. That's where most of the projects, what I see is, like, you know, they start good, but doesn't end well. You know, so you basically, right, the architecture is not that, you know, you just learn from, you know, book or, you know, by a training course or something. And what you need to do is, like, you need to understand the, you know, actual concept of the architecture. That's my point. Like, you know, you need to understand why we need this and how we need to implement this and connect to, you know, integrate with other technologies and things like that. If architecture is not good, then obviously the building collapse. Similarly, you know, same with the projects. Yeah.
Right.
TOGAF. I'm not quite enjoying the architecture. Basically, the problem with me is that I'm a console guy. If you ask me to write a, you know, Oracle backup script, I can write it for, like, you know. Typing, and I love PuTTY, connecting databases, installing systems and troubleshooting these and that. I'm a guy, so I mean in architecture is something like you just have to deal with MS Word and Visio and Outlook. This is the three tools what you have, that's it, every day same thing. I'm not quite enjoying it, but TOGAF can give me, if I go back to my, you know, previous, you know, solution architecture or basis or anything as a lead basis guy, what I can, like, you know, sell myself, like, I want to sell myself that, you know, I know the architecture, like, you know, if you implement, I can clearly explain them the architecture of Oracle and HANA and DB2 or IX operating system, Windows and Linux, SUSE, these and that. These things I can explain to the client, and, you know, probably influence the client to make a decision, you know. Yeah, that's it from me.
Sure, thank you, Saeed.
Yeah, this is important for me.
Nice. Yeah, that is why we are here. We are all here. And I think you told me the last time that when this became so important in your minds, you formed a group to make this training happen so that you learn together something that you all probably want, which is the architecture concepts. All right, so I think I have what you said on the written down on the screen. And today, for after a long time, I think I have an audience which I expect for an audience for an architecture training, because unless a person has worked quite a bit across the industry in any role, and it doesn't even have to be IT only, it could be anywhere, unless somebody has worked in few different places and interacted with many people for at least minimum, I say minimum 10 years, but today's, looking at today's generation, I think the length of time need is shortening every day. So today you might find a 5-year experienced person speaking a similar language which people spoke after 10 years of experience earlier. So I think that is the one important reason, is the availability of information and the speed of information that gets passed today is tenfold faster than 10 years ago. So that is one big reason why people get to that level or that kind of language of experience earlier. But that will keep changing, so it doesn't matter too much to us. But let us see.
Yeah, Anshu, and one more thing. See, whatever we are learning today, or this with the TOGAF, mm-hmm. we want to implement that and see how it is being implemented in the organization, how to make use of it. I think that's more our focus, all three of us. Focus is that we want to do that yes. role, but how to use that, and if we can use it and can we enjoy that, that's something that we'll have to discover later. But at this stage, yeah, we want to see how this will get implemented or used.
Correct. Yeah, so enjoyability part, definitely I will make the training hopefully interesting so that you find it important to learn, not just as a subject, but we are becoming if you were not an architect, I would say we are becoming architects with this training, but I think all three of you are acting as architects in one or another role. So I would say that we will realize that a lot of activities that we are already doing is a part of architecture, and we will start visualizing how to relate what we do today with the big picture of your organization, of your department, of your business, wherever you are. So that should help. And important thing is, as you mentioned, with this training, we are actually learning not just the subject, but being able to utilize it everywhere, in every yes. role, every department, every organization, wherever you go or wherever you are already. All right, so let us start with a quick example. Just to understand the concept of architecture, why is it important, or how, not even why, but how does it become important for organizations at some point of time. So I think it is almost 6 years, 5 to 6 years, when I visited a manufacturing firm which used to make plastic components. For home appliances. So the home appliances like TV, fridge, ACs. So there are a lot of components which go inside these appliances to either hold wires, hold circuit boards, fix things into one place, not to make them move. So there are many items. If you have seen a TV or a fridge opened up, then you might realize that there are corners and edges of those appliances where a lot of small plastic components are used. And even a little larger as well. For example, our set-top boxes. Cable-related boxes. Okay, now before I go further, please remember that this is your training. So whenever you have a question or you have a comment, you can interrupt and we can talk about it. As long as it is related to this, we can definitely take it up. And if it is something a little advanced, I will see how to place it, whether to park that question for now and then give you enough information for the moment and then move on. But just remember that you can ask questions at any point of time. And during the discussion, if you are typing on the chat, can somebody just type something and send, just say a hi or something on the chat right now? I am trying to see that if I get notified. So did somebody type something?
I typed, we are listening. I don't know whether
you got that. So on the screen when I am working with
can sharing... you see the chat now?
Yes, I can see the chat when I open it, but I don't get notified. So while we are talking here, the notification doesn't come. So okay. If you are typing something on the chat, you can keep it for record and then remind me that
you should you should have received now.
Yeah, I am seeing the chat. I can see the chat only when I open it, man, means myself.
Oh, okay.
So start getting the notification. Yeah.
So it's like a bubble or something pops up sometimes in some tools, right? So that is not happening here, which is okay. So you can type in the chat if you have a question or if you find some information somewhere on internet, you can paste it there and then just tell me that I want you to look at it or what is it. So then I can go to the chat and check. We are just trying to form some rules so that you get what you expect. So it shouldn't happen that you are typing something and asking me some question and wondering why am I not answering. All right, so it's just remind me whenever you have any such thing in the chat. Okay, so and before we move on, let me just quickly talk about our breaks. So we will try to take a break in every 1.5 hours. That is that works for everyone.
Fine.
You don't need quicker breaks. Sometimes people are used to get up every 30 minutes or 40 minutes.
I think once, no, today it's okay. Let's see how it goes. And maybe from tomorrow we can have break every hour, if not half an hour.
Okay.
Probably. I think today is fine, 1.5 hour. But yeah, I think.
Yeah, that is a useful suggestion. So whatever works for all of us, we'll try that. Okay, so I visited this place, this company, which makes plastic components for home appliances. And I, it was about 50, 60 people that used to work there. Not a very large place, but fairly sizable amount of big area. About, I think it was about 3,000 to 4,000 square feet of area where they were located. So I met their manager and the financial people and even the people who were working on the ground. So this manager I was talking to, I gave him a very basic question from an architect's point of view. All right, and this was just a friendly visit, so it is nothing like I was visiting there as an architect, although I was an architect at that point of time as well, but that was not the purpose. So my first question to him was, okay, and before that question, one more thing, that this company has suppliers who supply the raw material to them. Then the company converts that raw material into the plastic components that I was talking about. And then there are buyer companies who buy those. So buyers are the home appliance companies. Like you would have heard of Bajaj, Videocon, these companies who made these appliances at that point of time. And so those companies would buy those components from them. So it's like they would place orders for certain components, and then the company would start making the components. All right, so now there are external people also involved, suppliers and buyers, and this is the company itself, in the box that you see on the right side. Okay, now let us ask the manager the question. So the first question I asked him or her, I think it was a him, was if they had okay, I'll not write the whole question, it's just a summary, but I will describe it to you. If they had any returns of the orders, any orders in last 1 year, and what kind of return. So, and a return means the buyer has placed an order. Now you have manufactured, let's say, 1,000 units of a certain plastic component. And out of them, let's say 100 were found to be defective and they came back. So essentially returns means defective returns. So this was the question, whether they had defective returns of any orders in last 1 year, and when and what. All right, so when we say when, it's simply around the dates, and what means how much of the order was returned, who was the buyer or who was the returnee, and why was, means what's the reason for return. All right, so how much and reason. So out of 1,000 units, let's say 100 units were returned. This is just an example, but the question is an open question to the company. So right now when I am asking the question, I am not aware whether they had any returns at all. So it's just an open question, just trying to find out their experience with some of the suppliers versus buyers. So now what happened is this manager called three of his people who worked with him and gave him some instructions, asked a few things from them. Then they went to a big wardrobe where there were a lot of physical files lying. So they pulled out some of those documents, put it on a big table, and started going through those. The three people that the manager had called, and in between they asked the manager also a few times, but they were working independently. So it's not like they are asking questions in front of me, but I could see from a distance that they need some inputs. So after going through those 3 to 4 large files for about it was more than 2 hours, that they came back to the manager and to this manager who I was talking to, and then gave him some information. So now the manager told me that about 6 months ago there was one return from us, a buyer. I will just call buyer B, ABC, like that. From the buyer B, that was about 6 months ago, for 5% of the order. So 5% would mean out of 100, five things, so out of 1,000, 50 units. And they told me that the reason was color. So after a few hours of going through these files, more than 2 hours, they were able to get me the information that I was looking for, and that manager also got interested that, oh yes, this is an important question, this is a useful question. Now I gave them another question, so let's create another page here. because once we understand why are we doing all of this, it will be easier for you to either explain it to somebody else and understand it for yourself, because you are all doing architecture work at some level. So my second question was, who is your best client? And based on what criteria? So now another interesting question. So best is a subjective question, right? So it's just a word. And that is why these criteria are important, that what do you consider your buyers or suppliers or any of the people who you do business with, on what basis do you consider them one better than another for the company? So now the same thing, similar thing happened again, that they, the three people who this manager was talking to, again went back, pulled out some more documents, again went back to the table, started looking for information, and after about 4 hours, so this was even longer, they could come back that we had A and B, buyers who they consider among the best, and they had almost 20 separate big and small buyers who used to buy those plastic components from them. So the actual list of buyers is long. Having 20 separate buyers is a good amount of separate buyers, and these A and B were the best. Now from the point of view of the criteria that they decided, so now the criteria that they gave us was, first is there is length of relationship with the company. So A was about 15 years relationship, and B about 10 years. First was length of relationship. Another one was timeliness of orders and payments. Consistency of orders and payments. So timeliness is one thing, and consistent, that it is regularly happening every month, every 2 months, whatever their pattern was, whatever their needs were, but it is regular. So based on these criteria, and there were few more, but these were the most important ones. And yeah, there was one more important one was communication with the company. Or you can say communication with people. So they were good at meeting and making sure that their orders are happening and regularly meeting just to understand what's going on, how is it going on. So that was one more. So based on these four criteria, they considered A and B both as their best customers, best clients. So now again, what after my two of these questions, now that manager was curious that what you are asked. I asked him that why are we spending so much time in finding this information? Do you think it is necessary? Do you think it is necessary, Shahid, Arif, and Hidayat?
It's necessary to understand what exactly is happening. That's where you
right.
No, I think the necessary. It's a necessary. What you are asking is because you are trying to understand out of. to get to know all these things, why they are spending so much time and how can you reduce it so that they can get it quicker or something like that. That's what I'm thinking. So the background of the question you are asking could be you want to know why it is taking such time. So is there something else they could tell quickly so that something you can provide? I don't know. That's what I'm imagining. That could be your
yes
idea behind it.
Yeah, you are close. Point is that are these questions important? So we will, we have to wonder about the time taken to answer these questions is because if these questions are considered as important by that manager or by the whole company, then we will worry about how much time it takes. So if for example, you were doing something which does take 10 hours, but it does not happen frequently. Yeah. So it happens like once in a year or once in 2 years. Then you wouldn't worry about whether it takes 10 hours versus 8 hours.
Yeah.
But how important is it? So I asked him that if you have a new client, new supplier or a new buyer who you are getting associated with, they would be easily going asking you these kind of questions just to find out how do you operate today. And what are your values, your principles? Anybody can ask. Anybody in the sense, any new company who wants to get associated with them, or even existing ones might be interested based on how people change inside the company. Let's say a new CEO came or a new CFO came and he or she doesn't know about these things. So he just set up a meeting that, okay, let me meet all of my vendors. So these questions could be very common, could be easily asked in a business setting. So although this manufacturing company was doing well in terms of manufacturing the components and then supplying it to the right people, whoever needed it, that business was okay. But these questions can help you understand yourself and place the big picture or your good picture about your own company to others. So then the manager got curious that these things look like important, but now I have to worry about why we are spending so much time. So
I think you are trying to assess what is important to them and what they consider as important and what they don't worry about, it's not a priority once. So there is, you are doing an assessment to see with the questions you are framing. So what was this really important to my client, what I'm going to do work? So which are their priority or important ones, and which are not their priority or not that important ones? Maybe there is an assessment you are doing. That's how I understand.
Correct, kind of. So even when we say ask our first question, that defective returns of the orders, right? So the manager might have answered that, oh, we don't care about returns. And then I would know that even if there were returns, they don't care. So that also tells us about their values, the principles, that whether they really worry about wastage, because when a return happens, then it takes up your time, it takes up your resources again to create or manufacture the missing components or the returned components again to fulfill an order. So based on these questions, they would understand themselves also, and the person who is asking the question is also understanding how this company operates, what are their values and principles, and whether I want to do future business with them, or whether I want them as my suppliers. If I was another new company who wants to get more plastic components with their help.
In the earlier days, returns were not that important, but in coming days, I would personally, if I do any business or any shopping or anything, returns, people are looking for the easy returns concept. If you look at the online business nowadays, because the business model has changed very drastically since maybe 6-7 years, when online shopping has become, from a small thing, from, you know, even cars can be bought online nowadays. Yes. There are things which you can't buy online, but unless you feel it, like, you know, you wear it and then you feel it. But still people doing because of the time, and they look for this kind of a business model. That's why the companies are coming out to for, like, you know, to attract the customers, that, you know, easy returns. Like, you look at the Amazon, like, you know, it's a really great, it started from Amazon, I believe, easy returns. Like, you know, even they include the postage to return the thing, you know, no questions asked. So yeah, companies look for this kind of thing, you know. That back then, if you are talking about like 7-8 years ago, companies wouldn't bother. But now, it matters.
Correct. So now, when the manager got curious, what happened is what you just mentioned, that he asked me that, oh, this looks important, but now how do I make this process easier? Because the point was, I told him that you have the information. Information was there in that big wardrobe that they had in their office. Just that it was organized such that their orders, payments used to happen fine, just to serve the orders and payments, not anything else. So now that means, if the information was organized so that they can answer these kind of information questions, then it would become more useful. So it is actually just rearranging the same pieces to suit the business. So when we think of enterprise architecture, we think of rearranging either information or people or processes so that it becomes useful for general business. So now what first thing for the first question when we were talking about returns, I suggested that you see one important thing is you do not want returns, which means when returns happen, you realize that something could be fixed even in the first place, even before the first order went to the buyer. So create a return document separately. So that way you don't have to go through orders and payments and hundreds of other pieces of information to figure out if something was returned. So create a return document, and whenever something happens, and it's not a very frequent thing, so in their company the last return that they mentioned was about 6 months ago, right? So returns are not happening in that place very frequently. Even if they did, if whenever a return happens, you make an entry that this was the order, this was the buyer, this was the date of return, date of order, reason for return, how much, how many units, a document which will record the return. That's it. So now if you ever want to look back at any point of time, whether 2 years, 5 years, you have some place to quickly look at and find out information about returns. And this document also helps you improve. So this reason of a return is important, because when you, even after 6 months today, if you look back at that order, have you already fixed that reason for future buyers? How did you fix it? So it is a learning for the company. So first thing suggested was this return document, return related document. Now where do they keep it is another story. Architecture does not really care about whether you store the information physically or you hold it on computers or digitally. That is your choice. Architecture does not force people to follow a certain tool or technology specifically. But having the document is important. Having the relevant information is useful for the business, as long as it serves the business. So point is business, the organization itself. Now for second question, again, we got another document created where they had these criteria for clients and the clients listed. So in terms of that, length of the relationship, order, frequency, what was the other thing, payment. Payment frequency, any backlogs, and finally the buyer name. So you can rearrange the columns as your business needs or as suitable for you, but we are just writing some of the components of the document that could become useful for them. So now if they had these kind of documents before, they would be able to answer those questions in maybe less than 10 minutes or even less than that, because they are maintaining that kind of information somewhere. All right, so that brings up an important point that enterprise architecture is not doing something completely new that you never knew of. It's just rearranging the way you do things so that it becomes useful for the business. So in very simple layman terms, that is what enterprise architecture does. If you are explaining it to somebody else or understanding it yourself, this is the easiest way to understand that just rearranging existing information, existing processes, resources, so that it becomes useful for the business. And in the process, you will usually discover a few additional need for processes or need for more information like this. So this returns document is a new document. So you can always say that I have a new piece of information, but the content of this document is gathered from existing pieces of information, order related information, payment related information, buyer related, everything is already there somewhere else. This document is simply reorganizing this stuff which is useful for the business. So let us write that. So is this understandable to everyone up to here?
This makes sense to me.
Perfect. So because once you start relating it to your current work, wherever you are, whichever role, we don't even say that it is this is useful for the business. You can say useful for the organization, because not every organization is a business. Some organizations work not as a business, but just to help people. So even for a small or a big firm, whether it is operating as a business or not, this is useful. Enterprise architecture by itself. Because even in today's till today's date, I have also helped some of the organizations who are not businesses, and they have still utilized enterprise architecture equally. All right, so now when we start getting into some of the internal concepts of enterprise architecture, you will be able to relate, because once you understand that whatever we are doing is useful for some organization or your own organization, then you will find interest in that. That's a big thing, that as long as we are interested, we will do things. Otherwise, we keep postponing our work. And that applies to not just business, that applies to your general life also. If you find something interesting, you will keep doing it. Otherwise, even if it is important and not interesting, it may get postponed. So let's say a very easy example, movies. Some people like to go to movies, some people do not. And let's say your family is asking for going to a movie for some time and you are not interested. So you might try to keep postponing for a month or so. And then one day when everybody gets really angry that, okay, today is the last day, we'll not have food if we don't go to movie, then you will have to go. Because then the importance, now your interest doesn't matter. The home cannot operate without food. So then it becomes so important that you have to go. So enterprise architecture tries to avoid such things as much as possible, whether it is on home front or any organization's front, just helping you create a better, easier mindset, mindset to operate, which is useful for the organization. All right, so now in enterprise architecture, what happens is this picture that you just saw a glimpse of, this picture is very important, and you don't have to worry too much right now about what is written on this, because this picture will appear during our training more than 1,000 times and probably even more than that. So you will eventually easily able to remember it, and actually there is nothing to remember because you will understand the flow of things. So then you can close your eyes and create this yourself. This is the direction it flows. It is a clockwise direction, and this is called Togaf's ADM. So just to give you a quick glimpse of what we are going to do later on. ADM is architecture development model. Now remember that if you are trying to write down some things or take notes, it is okay if that is your habit, but do not worry about writing down everything on the screen, because the document will be available to you. And I think you all I am informed that this basic document you already have, and whatever we are doing on this document, like this example, and we will keep doing this kind of whiteboarding all the time during the training to understand things, to explain concepts, to when you share some examples from your own work, which is important that you bring up something that, oh, now I understand why I was doing this. So and during this training it does happen a lot with many people that they suddenly start understanding the bigger picture of what they were anyway doing, but with less awareness that why is a certain operation happening.
Can this this recording can be shared, like, you know, whatever we have done, like, you know,
yeah, I think this will come.
Your recording, yeah,
this will come to you.
Okay, thanks.
And the frequency of it, I think we can decide, and sometimes depends on how long it takes to actually save on the servers and then share it with you. So probably because this training is a weekend training, so we will target it like once we end on Sunday, by Monday you should have the document, so that during the week I would recommend that maybe spend 10 minutes a day, each day during your week, just to revise what happened in with the help of this document or the recording. So whatever methods that you want to choose, that is up to you, but just spend 5 to 10 minutes in revising, because usually this training happens like 5 days in a sequence or 4 days in a sequence, so then there is no gap, and when there are gaps you need something to rely on, just to remind you that, oh, these are the topics, or what did you do. Retention is always dependent on how much we act on any subject. So architecture development model is something that is the heart of TOGAF. I'm trying to draw a heart here. Yes. So the whole TOGAF architecture revolves around ADM, the architecture development model. So as we go along slowly, we will learn all about it. We will learn every single circle and arrow and box around it. Now let's see, what's the time? Oh, so it's almost Not almost. Now it is 1.5 hours from when we started. Let us take a break. And then we will get deeper into the course. So let us take a break for 30 minutes. So then we can take a 30-minute break because I also need to eat, if that is okay with everyone.
So it's not our breakfast time, but that's okay. Yeah, but we can take if you want a break, we can take a break.
Yeah. You have your dinner.
Anshu.
Yes.
Is it also called as development method? Or development, it's called as model, you know, when you expand ADM.
Those words are exchangeable. Architecture development method or architecture development model. Thanks for pointing that out. It's not that strict.
But I've seen some places they say method, some places model.
Method. Okay, so let's take a break. We will come back and discuss this further. I will go on mute.
Okay.
All right.
Here it is 11:30. We'll return back on 12 o'clock.
12 o'clock, yeah.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Cheers.
Thank you.
On mute.
Thanks.
Pause the recording.
I'm trying to pause the record. Can I just click on stop recording?
Yeah, stop recording, then we do in the chunks, as soon as we
This conference will now be recorded.
Now it's recording.
Okay, cool.
Thanks for that reminder. Okay, so for architecture development method, model sometimes can be used. We will learn a little later that whenever you try to devise a process for doing anything, it can be referred to as model also. But in books and in most other places, you will find architecture development method. Although you will start remembering it very soon because we are going to look at it many times during our training. So let me describe this model to you right now as a bird's eye view. And it's not just about that picture that I'm going to explain. It is about any organization, how will it operate either on its first day or sometime when a big change is expected in the organization. So usually that is what triggers architecture in most places. But let us observe what is happening. So the first circle that we see in our picture here is a preliminary phase. So what happens is, let's say this company is having some operations already, and the CEO or the CIO was driving somewhere and he or she saw a big hoarding on the road about a competitor. And that competitor's board was telling something about being able to order their products through a mobile app and lot of interesting customer-friendly things. using their devices, mobile device, tablets, computers, whatever, maybe even a watch, the smart watches that you have today. So a competitor's advertisement. So now this CXO, the chief something officer, suddenly thought that, oh, this is something interesting and we are not doing this in our organization. So I want to find out how is that possible. So now he or she comes back to his office and starts talking to some people who he regularly speaks to, and then figures that this is this looks like a big change and probably you need to talk to some architects. So sometimes architects exist in an organization, like you people are solution architects. Now architects have many domains possible. So when the CEO decides to talk to some architects that how to make this change happen, probably there is nobody at an enterprise level architecture. So he tries to find out if there is somebody outside and gets the right people. So now you have one or two enterprise architects talking to the CEO and trying to figure out what is happening. So this is the time when we call it as a preliminary phase. Preliminary means you are preparing for a change. So even for a startup, something that is just starting up right now, preliminary phase means few people are sitting together and trying to work up an idea for a new company or whatever that is, a new organization. So I will describe it in both fashions, but right now let us continue with this example. So now this team starts sitting and discussing that how this should happen. So now when we say how, we are not talking about the mobile or this advertisement itself right now immediately, but the CEO describes that, okay, I saw this board and now I think our organization is not doing something which is friendly for customers on devices, mobile devices or tablet devices. So now how to go about it? So the architecture starts creating a request for work, and this is a request for architecture work. So this is a document that is referred to in architecture terminology, and it is essentially a request that is like coming from a stakeholder to the architects. So the request is from the stakeholders to the architects that, okay, we need to do this work, can you help us with all the guidance that is possible. Now with this request, we as architects, now I am thinking of our group as architects right now, so we start deciding that whatever documents that we produce based on for this effort, we need some place to save them. So we decide on a repository, we also decide on a framework that what process we will follow to experiment with this change, what process should we follow to try out whether this change is possible, and what will happen, how many people, what kind of processes, what kind of people, applications, processes, data, anything that will be needed. But we need to follow a framework. Framework means a set of guiding principles, and we decide that we will follow TOGAF. So if you have heard of TOGAF's full form, the expansion of TOGAF. On the next page, let us write it. I think some of you might already know it. You can speak. What's the expansion of TOGAF?
Is anybody... the open group architecture framework.
Right. So the open group, which is the creator of TOGAF, the open group. So the first three characters is the group itself. And AF is architecture framework. So do you understand what a framework is? You may have seen some other frameworks in your organization.
Yeah, we have a, in defense, we have a separate framework called DOD, DODAF, defense, blah, 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 something, architectural framework.
Correct, Department of Defense.
Department of Defense framework. And there are many other frameworks, but a very famous framework is like another one is what is the tariff? I mean, JEDA always refers to is Archimate.
Archimate, okay.
Yeah, Archimate, yeah.
Right, but do you understand what a framework is? And then yeah, we'll
framework
talk about
is you have a set of rules and you know how you policies and defined predefined policies and the standards and problems solutions in terms of patterns and then you have that's all I
exactly
at the moment. Yes.
Yeah, you got it right. So frameworks are usually a set of guidelines and it offers a lot of tools like documents, templates for us to operate a certain type of operation. So when we say architecture framework is going to give us guidelines, tools, templates on architecting any organization, on architecting any business. So you may have seen software frameworks or software development framework. Even SAP has a few frameworks of its own. I know that because SAP has so many interesting big software around the world. So essentially it's a set of rules, guidelines, tools and templates which are available to us. Now, it's not mandatory to use, but it becomes useful to use as an organization. So it's like you have, say, from one place, from India to Australia, you have multiple routes to go. You can go via Hong Kong, you can go via London, or there are probable different routes. And everything is available to us. Now, what do you use to decide a certain route for yourself? So framework is something of that sort, that the guidelines that you would use to decide a certain process, that is your framework. So when I decide how do I go to Australia, I would first want to consider maybe time. Time is one thing, but now I am thinking that okay, if I have a stopover in between, let's say Singapore, so I would want to take a look at Singapore also for maybe a day and then continue to Australia. So I am using some of my preferences to decide my route to my final destination. So similarly, frameworks help us decide a certain process or a certain business, and TOGAF is one of them. And for that matter, TOGAF is the most popular architecture framework.
So you have a goal, and to reach the goal, what path you take is architecture framework. path.
So the path itself is not the framework.
Path itself is not a framework, but the decisions you take during, you know, following
something
the path
that will help you take the decisions.
Help you is take, yeah.
So practices or, you know, principles or something like that, which will help to form the framework, right?
Correct. So guidelines, tools and techniques, templates if possible, and then principles. So framework will give us all that. So that is our next step, that we are preparing for the change. We created a request for architecture work. We decided our repository that this is. So now imagine that repository can be anything. It could be a physical file that you might start using, like you might have seen in small medical stores or even a small kirana shop, general store kind of place. They sometimes use a physical register to record their transactions or record the inventory items in their shop because it is small. So now the repository where you keep your documents can be anything, whether it is physical or digital. It is up to you, whatever suits the business. So architecture work is very flexible in that regard, that use things that suit your business. We don't recommend anything. So as an architecture framework says use something for the repository. That is important. Now, what do you use for repository is up to you.
Yeah, it can be SharePoint, it can be here in defenses.
SharePoint or Google documents or whatever.
Open text, OneDrive or whatever. Yeah.
Or you develop something on your own within your organization. That is up to you. Okay, and then we decide our framework also. So these are some preparatory steps for our preparation for the change that we are imagining that that should happen. Next happens is phase A of ADM. ADM phase is architecture vision. Vision means now we are going to decide that what are we trying to achieve. So the vision statement can and see, remember that whenever we are working as architects, you are always you will find it always useful to work with the stakeholders. So sometimes people get into a mode where only architects are sitting and then nobody else is there, and that will happen a lot of times. But whenever you have to decide, you have to make decisions that okay, this is our vision statement or this is the process we are going to follow, then at that point of time you should be involving the stakeholders. Now in this example, our stakeholder is this person or a group of people who are bringing that issue to us, the CEO or the CIO in this example. But a lot of times stakeholders can be a little more, like 4 or 5 people sometimes who all have the same type of concern, but it varies. So working with the stakeholders to decide a vision first. So based on our preparation, we know what is their request. So now we help decide a vision for the work. So this is not a vision for the organization, but this is a good time to review the vision for the organization also, because I have seen by experience in some places that although the organization is working, they are doing their stuff, they are making products or services, whatever operations they are doing, but the vision is not very clear. What are they trying to do? Are they just earning money or are they making some difference? So this is a good time when vision for the organization is also reviewed and confirmed that okay, this is your vision. And if it is not there, then create it. with the help of stakeholders right away, because that will help drive the rest of the work, not just for this time, but for the future of the organization. All right, so in this example, the architecture vision would be enable the organization for mobile operations, or you can make the statement differently as your business suits. Enable organization for mobile, or you can say enable mobile technologies for the company ABC, whatever. Let's say this is ABC company. All right, so a quick small statement which doesn't have too many details, but it captures what do you want to do, or what the CEO or CIO has requested you to do. All right, so we create a vision statement, and then we also at a high level understand, and when we say understand, we actually create a diagrams. So we create a picture of the organization today, and we also create what we want to see it as. So it will be pictures of circles, boxes, different processes of the business, different departments here and there. And today it looks like this, and in future you are probably adding some mobile related processes or mobile related departments. So it is adding few things in the same picture. Usually it is the same picture with additional components, because in future also you may not be removing things from the organization, but probably modifying few existing departments and maybe adding few additional processes. So let us add a new color here so that it is easier to visualize. So let's say this existing circle, wherever I am putting a blue color, this means that circle is slightly modified, so slightly improved. So that business process still exists, but with additional features. And then we have a new process. This is completely new, and this is also completely new because of this change. So we picture our business at a high level. High level means you are not going into every single process, every single detail inside those departments or those processes, but naming them that, okay, we will have a sales department, we have an R&D unit, we will have an HR department, we will have a sales and marketing. Sales I already mentioned, marketing also, and then we will have a separate mobile enablement department. So something of that sort. You will start creating pictures with this vision in mind. So this is a high level, which means just at the level of naming of the processes and departments. So that is a vision phase. Vision phase also creates a document, important document called statement of architecture, which is a result of this. So once you know where you stand today and where do you want to get in future, you can put that information in this document. And TOGAF provides templates for every single document that it mentions. So as we move along the course, I will start showing you how to go to those templates, or where to see them, where to find them. So for now we are just taking a high level picture. So this statement of architecture work document is a response to this request of architecture work. which we did in preliminary phase. So we just consider that as a response to that document. All right, and now we reach a phase B. B relates to business. Some of the processes you will notice, some of the circles in the ADM model you will notice correspond to their activity also. So when we say A for architecture vision, it's a coincidence. B for business architecture is also a coincidence. So some of them actually correspond to the name of the phase also. So in business architecture, you design the business. So now you will, what we were discussing here, today's picture of the business and future picture of the organization, you will do that in detail. So every single process, every single department, people who are involved. So people. Now remember that this is at the business level, so you will still be considering what the sales department is going to do, what the R&D department is going to do, all right, at a business level. So again, pictures of today and tomorrow will come, today and future. From a business perspective. And what happens is whenever you sit with stakeholders, collect information from them, and sometimes you design the pictures in front of them if they are interested. Otherwise, you come back to your architect's work area, and based on that information, you brainstorm among yourselves that, okay, we understood this, we understood this, and then let us start designing. Creating the diagrams, pictures, documents, what we have from the stakeholders. And once you are ready, you, or even in between, one, let's say half the picture is done and you want to go back to the stakeholders to confirm that what you are doing is what they visualize the organization to be doing. So you can always go back to them, take an appointment, again show them the pictures, diagrams, that okay, this is how we visualize our business right now, and keep getting their approvals. Now the next phase is C, and this is information systems architecture. This covers applications and data. Now, when we say applications, remember that we don't need names for a certain application or a certain tool or a technology, at least at this point of time. That will come a little later. You might ask me that when do we actually do that, and that will happen soon. But at this point of time, what you do is, based on this today's and future picture of the business, what kind of features do you need in your application, and what kind of properties do you need for your data? So properties means, let's say you are in a create products company. So your data would be customer data, inventory data. So you will start designing your data and your applications in this phase if you already don't have. And most of the times, if it is an existing organization, you do have some applications which you use within the organization to manage everything. So you consider those applications and then start imagining or writing down features that are needed for this particular change that you are doing. So from an application point of view, you can think of, let's say, a search capability or sorting capability, sorting of items. Then you want to be a geolocation enabled, which means what is happening in which location should be also available to you. So you are deciding properties of an application, but you are not naming a particular application. All right. And it may happen that in an existing organization, you always have an application in the back of your mind, which is okay. You can actually document it during this process that based on the existing application called, let's say that application name is A. So based on the application A, we are going to use these features, and you can list those features. But you will also list what is desired. So there may be few more things that are desired based on your today's change that you are working with. Then once you are ready with today's applications and future applications, properties as well as data. So in this phase, we actually have application architecture and data architecture both in phase C. After this, we land on phase D, which is called technology architecture. So in technology architecture, what happens is hardware, software, and communication mechanisms. So even at this point of time, you don't name any products, but you mention their properties. So from a hardware point of view, you can say that I need, say, 100 GB of space on at least a 16 CPU machine or a server. And software wise, I need some database system, and I need an application server or 5 application servers. So you understand, we are not naming a product, but we are still listing their properties. One second, let me get some water. About what things? Hardware, software, and communication. So at this point of time, let's say you have a small shop. So if we are talking about a medicine shop next to your house, so from hardware point of view, maybe they need a computer, they will list that. Maybe they just need a physical notebook, so they will list that kind of thing, that we need a notebook with at least 500 pages with square boxes, or if it is a mathematical notebook, or they might say we need a notebook with lines on them, or we need empty pages, no lines, nothing, or in a certain format. So you mention the formats, you mention the properties of the hardware and software also for suiting your business. Then we need to reach the next phase, E. This phase is called opportunities and solutions. This is the first time when you see solutions, and this is the first time when you start naming things. So now in this phase, you will create a complete sequential document that, okay, when we do these things, then our architecture of today's versus future can start taking shape. So this document is created, and you will start mentioning your solutions. So if you have an application or if you already have some specific servers, like let's say Dell servers are there, or HP or Oracle specific servers are there, database systems are there, SAP is an application, right? So a specific application that you want to mention here. So this is the time when you will mention those things. So this completes the picture. So till now you were discussing designing the business, then you designed the applications and data, then you understood the technology behind what you are going to do, and then the actual names of things. So these are the real products. So this is the time when you take names of the products in your plan. So this plan that I mentioned, that you will have to create a document, this is a implementation plan, or we also call it as implementation and migration plan. And this is in initial state. So I am just putting an I here to mark it as initial. Then we reach our next phase, F. And phase F actually corresponds to what we are going to do in that phase. We finalize everything. So we finalize the plan that we just saw in the previous phase. So the same plan is reviewed and finalized. So I'll put an F here. This was an I for the initial planning, F for finalizing plan. And the name of this phase is actually migration planning phase. Similar to you remember opportunities and solutions that we wrote here for the phase E. Similarly, migration planning is this phase name, phase F. So in this phase, we finalize everything.
Question, yes, for you is, yes, sorry to disturb, but what exactly we are migrating? This, let's assume that, you know, the solution is a brand new solution, right?
So, correct.
So migration.
That is my question.
Yeah, migration.
I was going to ask the same thing. Okay. So that is for you now, for all three of you. What are we? Okay. So implementation, you understand that we are going, yes, to implement some steps.
What we are migrating? There's nothing.
What are you trying to migrate? Can somebody guess what are you migrating?
This, maybe the business model you are,
exactly,
migrating.
Yes. Not, so you are migrating the business from not doing the mobile related activities today to being mobile enabled. So you are actually migrating the business. So you guessed it correctly, and that is why this is called migration also. So that is a perfect, great question at the right time. If you did not mention it, I was actually going to ask the same thing after mentioning this name, that what are you really migrating? All right, so then there is a phase. Now remember that there are phases in TOGAF that you feel like they should be done in sequence, and that is correct, that many of these phases till now whatever we were doing is in sequence. This is useful to do in this sequence. Now organizations can and TOGAF allows that you can mix and match. So if you think business and applications go together for your organization, so then you can combine the phases B and C and then call it something else, or maybe just call it as B and C together and then use it. So you can customize, but we will talk about that later. For now, what I was trying to tell you is many of these phases appear in sequence. And you will realize that it is easy to remember that first you prepare, which is preliminary phase, then you decide a vision, that is phase A. Then we consider the business first, because business drives everything else. So business architecture first, then we go to application and data architecture, which the name of the phase is information systems architecture. Let me change the color a little bit to help you see in the diagram. See, once the diagram is complete, you might find that it is a lot of information on the same page. But as we are understanding it together, I hope that it works out for you. The picture is useful. So I'm just boxing the names of the names of the phase. So preliminary is preliminary. That is correct. Okay. So now this phase that you see here is called G for governance, and the actual phase name, complete phase name, is
implementation
governance. All right, so essentially this phase is talking about governing the implementation, which means now once your plan is ready for in the previous phase, that how are you going to implement things which will help your business, which will enable your business to change, then you are essentially monitoring that implementation. So you give that plan to the actual projects, you give that plan to the actual development teams, implementation teams, that document, and then start monitoring it. So that is the governance part that this phase talks about, the monitoring or the governance of the implementation. So let's say every 10 days or every 7 days, initially you sit with the implementation team, help them understand, describe the plan to them. If they have questions, answer them. And then as the implementation starts, governance means that we regularly interact with them to find out if they are okay, doing okay, which step or where have they reached in the plan, are they finding any challenges, do they need help. So governance means all those things. Now we will slowly also understand as we go along the course that governance also works across the organization in every step. So in implementation governance, you will realize that this governance is only about the implementation, but then there is a general governance which is also existing in every organization. So we will learn about that slowly, because that applies in every phase, that governing every single phase, how an architecture vision is happening, how preliminary phase is happening, whether it is actually happening or not. So those things fall under the bigger corporate governance. And then we'll end up on another phase. And again, this is not in sequence, this particular phase. It is there for the completeness of this picture. The phase H is change management. So phase management, change management, essentially I think all of you understand that how an organization deals with the change in terms of actual processes. So change management, you will notice that most organizations have a change management system. Usually it is a software somewhere where tickets come. So many places call them as CRs, change requests. So change management is mentioned in this picture just to complete this picture, that whenever changes happen in a business, this is how they are handled. So change management describes the whole system of changes in your organization, in your particular organization. Now there is a middle circle called requirements management, and that is also one system that should exist, and it affects every other process, every other phase that you will notice in an organization. So requirements can be for the vision or the architecture itself. Requirements can be for the business alone. Requirements can be for applications, data requirements, technology requirements. Let me change the color again to just to see these connections better. That requirement management connects to every single phase. Connects in the sense it can talk to every single phase. Requirements can be for any of the phase: technology, data, applications, business, different solutions, governance requirements, change requirements. So this is a central phase in this picture that you see.
So throughout the project, whatever it is, from the vision mm-hmm. to the requirement phase, yes, we understand, we can correlate it with any of our SAP projects, that requirements keep on coming. Like, you know, it can be any change, you know, requirement, we need this one to be added, or we need that functionality to be, you know,
correct.
Actual thing.
Exactly. So requirements management, as you just correctly mentioned, it says that the system should exist. Now, how and when will you handle those requirements is a decision to be made with the help of stakeholders and architects. So requirement management system just keeps taking the requirements. Now, let's say you are in the business architecture phase. As an architect, you are working, and you are right now, you are in business architecture phase. So then you look at the requirements management system and find out that, do we have a business requirement already for this change? If not, then create it. So usually what will happen is, as soon as you got the request for architecture work initially in the preliminary phase itself, when the CEO or CIO is talking to you, and then you decide, the CIO or any number of stakeholders, they said that yes, we want to do this. So then you log a change request in the change management system that, okay, now our business is going through a change and we will take it through a change management system. So you create a CR, and the requirements that you got there, you enter them in this requirement management system also, whatever you understood at that point of time. So in addition to these documents, you are making entries into requirements management repository also. So it is essentially a repository of requirements. Those requirements could be of applications, it could be data, it could be technology, it could be business itself, any requirements. So now you will also understand that the requirements management repository also needs some proper classifications of items, that what's the requirement, who is requesting it, what's the need for the requirements, what's the reason for the requirement, and which domain does it fall under. So whether it is business, data, applications, technology, what kind of requirement is it. So and maybe a date that when did this requirement come in. So you would have also experienced in your current or past organizations that even requirements management is something that some organizations maintain somewhere similar to a change management system, and if not, then you have to do it. If it is not existing, then you should have something which manages requirements, some kind of system. So now, does this picture make sense to you after we have discussed for a few maybe 30 minutes, I guess?
Yes. To me, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, all right, and it sounds very sequential and logical that this is how a normal business change could happen very easily if you follow a certain set sequence of steps.
Yeah, okay. What I understood, a majority of the things, it's all correlating to what we are doing in SAP. It's on a different way. For example, correct, if you say migration plan, what I understood there, whatever is in SAP, we call it as an as is process and to be process. So we actually map the as is current process of what there, they don't have a mobile app to do those things. That's the as is process, and to be process would be to get into the digitalization or whatever you called as enable org. So that's what the to be process, that's all we are migrating to it, from this to that, from the current process to this one. When you talk about change requests, it's all the same thing we also do in SAP or any other things. There is a change request, you know, the change methodology, what we do. So we love it, because for me, 90% more than it relates all of them to what we are currently doing, but in a different terminologies. Or exactly, you know, this, the whole thing is called as what do you call a framework here, you know, or open architecture, whatever framework, but we call in a, so there is a methodology in SAP called ASAP methodology. There are phases of, you know, the different phases, how you do one by one. So the way it is similar one, I'm saying.
That is SDLC, software development lifecycle, as is and to be. Is covered under SDLC. The migration framework, what he's talking is, let's say in a fine example for us is, yes, I mean, we worked, I mean, you know, in ASA that, you know, HR was the major key to handle. SAP HR is a key handle in ECC, right? So we shifted some of our business. Otherwise, I'll take another example, SRM, okay? For procurement, for these and that, you know, SRM was the technology we were using, right? So we shifted from SRM to Ariba. That is a migration. That is what he's talking here.
But I don't think, Anush, you tell me, it's only a terminology being used. It can be referred either way based on the client's need and how it's doing things now. In a nutshell, it could be, there could be many scenarios.
Both are correct. So when you mention a specific example, like what you just said, SRM to Ariba. So
SRM is a technology and system we used to use. Then they realize, can we go to cloud? Okay, cloud place. Which with the more more advanced features, blah 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 blah. So to reduce the footprint of the technology on the premise, let's say it is reducing the footprint. It's a big change. Footprint
so, yes. So that is your business change.
Yes,
the, that's reducing the, business. The footprint of whatever you just said. That is your business.
The server, the server for SRM server, we have to have a space. That costs, and we have to have the resources that will cost, the license that costs. So you are making a change in the business, like, you know, and you're migrating from the business, from the way business does in terms of like procurement. You are changing, you're migrating from one method to another method. I believe that's what this phase is talking about, you know.
Yeah, you can say that. So what you just said, that your SRM was migrating to Ariba, but remember that that is a technology change, and that is a result of a few other things. So the initial statement that you would have heard of, or maybe your business was talking about, is what was that? Cost reduction, and you said one more thing.
Yeah, footprint.
Footprint, business yeah. footprint, the footprint yeah. of the servers.
Technology,
probably.
You know, servers, yeah, technology footprint. Yeah.
Footprint of technology, reduction of that also.
Yep.
So this is your business change that you were working for.
Yeah.
Business change. And to help with that business change, you would have slowly decided that okay, from an application point of view, probably we need some different features. So probably that is why you have this Ariba, which has different or maybe more features. One reason. Second reason is technology wise also it is going to reduce and help your business. So many decisions finally in probably phase E, where we discuss the solutions, then you would decide that okay, instead of SRM we are going to move to Ariba. But till that time you are talking from the business applications data, all of those perspectives also. If you think of taking that change through TOGAF, so essentially first you are making a business decision that okay, we want to reduce footprint, we want to reduce costs. Okay, started. So now where are we today, where are we in future? So as I think who mentioned that, one of you were just saying as is and to be. So that also comes in picture here, that where are we today in terms of business and where are we going to be in terms of that particular change in terms of business. So we create our pictures or documents, whatever, as is and to be in context of that change. And then slowly as we reach application architecture, data architecture, is that changing? Maybe application architecture would be changing because you are probably planning to move to a new type of application, a different platform maybe. And then finally at the technology phase, you decide that hardware, software wise, there are few changes, communication mechanisms, few changes. And in opportunities and solutions phase, you name that, okay, SRM is moving to Ariba. So do you understand? Essentially, when we do architecture and when we are learning it today, you are going to find that now relating it to the work that you are doing becomes easy. Like you just mentioned some of the examples from your current work, and now you are able to relate that as is and to be. In TOGAF's terminology, we call it as current state and future state. And that is also easy to remember, current state and future state.
One question, Anshu.
Yes.
This architecture is all about rearranging this the existing into a new technology, or can we start using this ADM methodology? Can we start from the scratch?
Oh yeah, as I mentioned, even for a startup, only thing missing you will find is today's state, because there is nothing, but you always have a future state for a startup. So architecture work, TOGAF applies to any organization, whether it is starting, whether it is existing, whether it is 100 years old, as long as there is a change planned. So for a startup, the starting itself is a change, because today you don't have anything and you are starting to do a new business or a new whatever that idea is about the startup. So yes, it applies anywhere.
Okay. And each of the level or each of the phases will have mm-hmm. the artifacts.
Exactly.
Associated with it, right?
Correct.
So these now yeah. will that change? How do I ask that question? Will that change? I mean, do those templates that we have each phase is when we implement from SRM to Ariba or any other software, you know, like simple software, not that complex. So those templates, how would that help in each of the phases? I don't know whether I'm asking the right question, but
That's okay. We will get to that question. Which templates are you talking about? You mean the artifacts that each phase uses?
Yes.
Okay. So as we were going through this picture, you might have understood that from a business point of view, you created a today's picture and a future picture, right? So let us try to actually make it right now. So current, from an SRM perspective, you have process A, B, C, and C also has two divisions, D and E. Okay. In the future, with Ariba in the back of your mind, see, sometimes you already have the target product in mind that you want to go there, and it is okay. So designing it, keeping that particular product or keeping that solution in mind is okay, but you are still designing the business at this point of time. So let's say you are in phase B. So in future, I'm seeing that my process A, B, and C remain as it is, and D and E are no longer required because I have moved to Ariba. So you can see this footprint reduction, you can visualize in this picture.
Yeah.
Right. So from a business point of view, this the benefit is visual also, and then you can explain to stakeholders with the help of these pictures that okay, we will not no longer need these two pieces, or you can say maybe these are data centers, and because you are reducing the footprints, so instead of five data centers, now you will in the future state you will need only three. So you have reduced two of them, right? So the new state of the data centers looks better because it is reducing the footprint. So now what happens is this current state and this future state both are two separate diagrams that you just created, and you can put it in a common single picture also, like a PowerPoint or something which has both. It has current state also and future state also. So how you organize is up to you, whether you keep both of them in the same document, whether you have one document for current, one for future. So this is your artifacts. So from business phase, you created two artifacts. Now when we move on to, let's say, the next phase, phase C, which is going to talk about application properties.
Anshu, one data. Thing, sorry for interrupting.
Yes, go ahead.
What is artifact? Because these the other two people are working as an architect, so I'm not. So I'm just trying to understand what is that we are referring to.
I can explain him.
Sure,
my way. Artifacts. Let's say, for example, you have a you want to implement something in PA30. Okay, new feature. Mm-hmm. So for that, Sandeep asked you that, you know, can you create a document for me to, so that if you leave, you know, how other people can handle. So you created a document that is called artifact.
So which illustrates the development of an
anything, requirement. Anything. Any document, Intogap terminology. Correct me if I'm wrong, Anshu. Anything, any document you submit, a troubleshooting document, implementation document, or migration document,
or cutover plan, or this plan, that plan. Everything is artifact.
So correct. That means, Anshu, it falls on which phase here? That when we are talking, it's on business architecture. Does it falls there in that, where does this actually fit in?
Artifacts, as long as artifacts, deliverables, in every phase. For example, if you go to the business phase, you need to capture the requirement, right? So you create the documents. So those are all the artifacts of that phase, and that is a source of your next phase. You use those requirement artifacts of what is your business requirement. You prepared a document that is our business artifact, and then you use the artifacts you develop in one phase is a deliverable for next phase.
Yes, so as you pointed out correctly, that artifacts are any kind of documents that you either produce or you use. So whether it is a product of a previous activity, maybe you have 10 documents already lying with you which are useful. Maybe somebody designed your current today's structure of the business maybe 5 years ago. So you use that document also. So artifact is anything that you produce or you use in your architecture work. So, and it applies to every phase. So whether you are in application or data or business or even vision phases, you might be using some existing documents also in your organization, like say principles document, or you have vision already written by somebody, a picture already created for the business by somebody in the past, maybe 10 years ago, somebody created a picture. Everything is an artifact. Every document that you use or produce is an artifact.
So it's a terminology used to refer the documents.
Any document, even emails or documents, artifacts.
Yes, so terminology wise, artifact is a general architecture term where we mention anything as an artifact, any document that we produce or use. And slowly as we go along the course, we will also find official definitions of artifacts, which are not necessary to be remembered. You don't worry about remembering a particular thing, but if you understand, you will be able to describe and utilize in your architecture work.
Yeah, that's right. That's what I was even saying earlier when we spoke about migration planning. The migration word is not the thing. It is what we are doing. It can be, it is not a hard and fast rule. We can use only migration for that purpose. Even when you migrate from an application, one version to another version, it's also called a migration, right? So, so it is not a hard and fast rule to say, okay, migration means it is only to this. It is based on the process, what's the current and future it's happening, and what you are trying to move from one to a new phase, new dimension from one currently what's happening. So it doesn't fit it. Either it could be in a technological thing from one system to another system, or it could be with the one application with another version it goes also in migration. So it is based on the exact requirement of the thing, it comes into the name. So terminologies or naming is different. That's what I was trying to refer. Anyway, I got a clarification. Good.
So even that brings up an interesting point. That terminology or naming that you use in TOGAF. TOGAF is so flexible that it tells you that you can change the terminology. So if you want to call the business architecture phase as SAP architecture phase, you change the name of your phases within your organization. It is okay. If you want to mix C and D together, you want to do application data and technology, all three steps together, you can create a single box out of it and then do them together. So it is flexible in terms of technology, terminology, naming, everything. TOGAF says that suit your business. So essentially, whatever suits your business, use this framework according to your business.
Okay, good.
So it is super flexible. So if you want to call migration as moving or some other word which is more popular in your SAP as an organization, so then use it. Put it in your documents, mention it in the initial preparation, the preliminary phase. There is one more step that we do there, that when we mention the framework, we also mention the terminology change. We, in the initial phase itself, we also mentioned that we are going to use phase C and D together, or we are going to use E and E together, or E and F together, to suit your business.
Yeah, got it.
All right. So now you will realize probably that when you call somebody as a solution architect, you are probably working in this phase. But lot of times you may be expected to contribute to other places also, or helping decide the data, helping decide the applications properties.
Where did you say that?
In opportunities and solutions, the phase E, where you decide solutions.
Okay, but see, does TOGAF, I don't know whether I'm too early to ask that question, or whether TOGAF will not offer that thing.
Any question is okay.
SRM to Ariba, we know, you know, as in solution architect or as familiar with the industry.
Okay.
That SRM's next or future state is Ariba, because everyone is moving into cloud. Okay. Now there are thousands of applications, you know. Now an organization uses apart from SAP, don't take the complex ones or the known ones, like suppose Microsoft or Adobe or things like that. But there are other applications which they uses it or they want to use it. Now in that space, does TOGAF helps in any form to identify an application that is suitable for the organization in terms of the existing application, or they want to procure that application? You know, I'm not sure whether it offers or not, but that is all depends on the experience of a person, that, you know, what he does and what he does not. But I don't know whether we have that in TOGAF or not.
Okay, interesting question. So as we talked about it initially also, TOGAF prepares you as an architect. If you are an architect, you are the one who will be able to make those decisions for your organization about which application is suitable for a certain job or certain process. Now, TOGAF does have a list of products and solutions. When you reach the phase E, you will find that it is mentioned in the documents also. But it does not recommend a particular one for a certain type of work, because TOGAF is technology agnostic. So it does not, so it wouldn't say that you go with Oracle only, or it wouldn't say you go with SAP only, right? Or you go with IBM only, because to do the other, SAP also makes few things which Oracle also does, IBM also makes few products which SAP also does. Now people decide one product over another based on many criteria, and as an architect, you use those criteria to make a decision or help an organization to make a decision. So I will not always say that Oracle is the best for every possible solution. It may or may not be, or IBM or SAP for a certain solution. So what will I use is these criteria. So these criteria, as an architect, I would consider cost, I would consider ease of administering a certain application. You will also consider support, how good support is available for that particular process or a solution or a product.
But
so as long as you understand the criteria, you can make that decision. And architect is the answer. So what the question that you just asked, it's a very powerful question. And that is the whole point of being an architect, that you can help make the decision. If there was a tool which can do all of this, then there would be no need of architects.
No. Yeah, I understand that. What I was, now, when you're choosing the application that is right for the organization, right? It all depends on the architect, right? The architects sit together, the project managers sit together, the person who pays from his cost center, he sits. Now, when we talk about the vision, right, we can do a vision for the known products which are famous or which are like SAP, Oracle brand names, you can't use those. But what I'm trying to say is, I was involved in that platform.
You can hold on there.
Yeah.
So before you move your question further, just hold on.
I have something to share.
When you think of Oracle or SAP, so what we are saying is initially, and you will find this in any architecture framework, and TOGAF is the most popular, that when you think of a business change, you do not consider any product at all at that point of time. You think of the business, what the business needs. Technology will come when the time arrives, when you are in phase E or D, when you start wondering about, okay, which products will suit this requirement. Then you decide on whether to develop something in-house to suit your business or you buy an existing technology. That is a separate decision that will come later. But first thing is, does your business need a change? And if there is, then what is that change, how to visualize it, and then go through that process which we understood here. Solution wise, any technology, it could be SAP also, it could be Oracle also, it could be IBM, or it could be a startup also who might be helping you with a certain solution. So anybody can help. That will come later.
Okay, Anshu, I have got something to share.
Yes, go ahead.
You share first, then I'll share.
Arif's question was right, exactly. But the thing is, what you said with SAP or IBM or it is, I think the architect role should be to list out the pros and cons of the whatever the applications as a list. These are it could be any startup also, So this is all the, pros or cons of this. Then you come up with a recommendation. So this is what we will be good. That's what you are saying. But I think the decision is made not by the architect. It is with the management. So you are a guide. Yes, you are saying this is what the thing to be done. But finally, the management decides what to go on with. Why I'm saying this, stakeholder, whatever it is, there are places I've seen, even though the architect recommends this what to do, but the management decides something else to do, so based on other factors. I don't want to list out that here. So I've seen this, and even been advised by stakeholders, please do not talk further on this, because we have decided with this, though there are, you know what I'm trying to say. So it's a matter of the architect is, giving a layout or a guideline saying, so this would be the best to fit your requirement. But final, it is only with the stakeholders, because Arif is comparing with the current environment, what he is doing with and how they are moving it. It's a related question to his environment. I think in generic of an architect view, like you said, we should not look about that. We should be suggesting the applications which will do the, best of the ones. And from there, it is the management who takes off this. That's what I think from my understanding. So,
but see, my question was more towards, I know that even TOGAF or any other architecture will not give you this, this is the replacement software or the application that you can use if you want there is no guides to that. But more on the, maybe I'm asking these questions too early, because my more major question was on the app patterns, because we were building the app patterns. Now, the application that's been used or that will be procured will have to be fit into these patterns. So from TOGAF perspective, you know, what does ADM provides that? Is it only the steps of the architecture that it gives you, that you know you have a vision? The vision is already being decided by the business or by the stakeholder, that you know this is where I have to go. Now, in example, SRM to Ariba. So SRM, they knew that SRM is not going to work, or even if that is it will work, it will have different cost impacts and other things. So you decided that we'll go to Ariba. So now, then from the step B or phase B, then you start gathering the business architecture or business information, and then you start converting that business information into the artifacts, and then you go through the phases. Mm-hmm. Is that what ADM states that?
Arif, let's say I talk about one business model. Look at Amazon business model. Amazon came as a bookseller from the garage, right? Mm-hmm. And then once it grew, then who's that Amazon guy? I don't remember his name. He saw a business model. Which is like, I want this business to reach to this level. So initially that's an idea, right? So he put a vision, and then he started not just books, but he started selling other products as well. So that's a business idea. That's a vision he has got. And he started to achieve that. What exactly he requires? He require a supplier, what he wants to sell. First, you need to decide that. Okay, I want to sell the mobile phones online, right? Okay, what do you require for to selling the mobile phones? I'm a manufacturer? No, I'm not the manufacturer. So who is the manufacturer? Then he reached out to the manufacturers, and then the suppliers. I mean, you know, who supply the logistics, like, you know, manufacturers say, okay, I sell you the mobile phone for $700, and then supply cost and delivery, and then he has to decide the warehouse and how you going to warehouse, but does time, require the technology. Time. So this is the vision. Yeah.
No. You're moving from the architecture point of view to the business model.
No, this is everything is architecture, man. I mean, my question has got the architecture.
My question is more on the, obviously we wouldn't be setting up that business model. What I'm trying to ask is, maybe I'm asking too early, or I should be asking later. I'm relating the application patterns and the process that I was involved in the platform when they were defining the platform architecture for air services. So that moment, and so now they were deciding, they haven't, so the part that I was in, I'll just brief you that, they were deciding to move or have a platform, whether it is hybrid or private or public cloud platform, the business was trying to vision. They want to go to cloud, but they don't, they have a vision of going to cloud. But how they need to go to the cloud, what are the aspects, what are the applications that they need to consider, which vendor they need to choose, everything that is associated with that architecture, where we come into the picture and start asking questions, or start documenting those questions or those things that we require from the vendor.
Correct, and that is where you come in. So when you know that you may have to move, And let's say your business wants to move to the cloud, something they want to move something to the cloud. So now from your vendors, you start collecting this kind of information that what kind of support do you have? What kind of cost is there for each kind of server or application that you host? Do you bill us on hourly basis or do you do it daily billing? Do you have any discounts? Do you have an annual plan or a longer periods of plan? So you collect all of this from multiple vendors. So let's say vendor A gives you the same information, vendor B gives you another set of information. So now as an architect, you will be sitting with say five vendors similar information. Let's say some of them do not have an annual plan. So now you will help guide that decision that okay, we wanted annual plan and this vendor does not have it, so we will not consider that. And then finally come up with one of those or say two of those, and then let the stakeholders decide, because you are always a guide. You are not, see, as an architect, we are not decision makers.
Exactly.
Sometimes stakeholders give you that power, but that varies by companies. Sometimes stakeholders consider you as they can clearly tell you that okay, whatever you say, we are going to follow. So then you have more, slightly more power, but still the veto power, like somebody making a signature, is the stakeholder always. So architects work as to be done with stakeholders only.
Arif, let's say
I'll ask that question later. We will discuss that later.
Let me put my last point. Your vision says that you come up with a vision brainstorming. I need A, B, C, D, E. So this is what I want to achieve, A, B, C, D, E. Now, that
now
A,
that's
B,
C, what D, my e, question is, Shahid. How did you come up with A, B, C, D, E?
That is the vision the stakeholders decide.
See. The vision is, now in this example, the vision is moving to cloud. But there are hundreds, thousands of stuff.
Yeah.
You know,
Okay, simple.
In our example, we recently migrated to cloud, right? Who took that decision? Is it CIO who took the decision? Why they took the decision is they have the problem because the building was not, they were having the burden of paying rent and then as well as the burden of maintaining the hardware.
So I understand.
That's what I'm saying.
But no, I'm not asking that question at all.
Okay.
My question is something else. Shahid, maybe I'm asking too early. We'll discuss that later when the application patterns
and these and that they come as we go along. Not now. Arif.
Yeah. That's what. I'll ask that question later, probably.
Hopefully, that should become more clear as we go along. But right now, we are looking at a big picture. We just looked at the ADM for the first time, and now. I think you are already getting interested in the whole process because you are
really getting interested actually.
And this is important from an architect's work.
Not getting wrong, Shahid, but my expectation is too much from Tokyo.
Also,
I think Anshu. What Arif was saying, this is my understanding. So he is after, there are so many XYZ applications. How will an architect, using the ADF framework, using the templates or whatever it's called, how can we efficiently come to a point, okay, this would be the best fitment. Leave about SRM, Ariba, all those
exactly.
things.
Maybe
I understood what
it is. That is too early, yeah. Arif. I am trying to tell you. You haven't learned how to drive the car. You already worried that what car you want to buy.
I'm expecting too much from Togaf.
He's actually
I did say that, right? I did say mention that.
Yeah, I think he's relating his experience connected to that. It's quite natural. So I don't have any experience like that, so I'm keeping quiet. So Arif has got an experience like that, so he's trying to point out and say, okay, how do we efficiently decide using this technology or whatever, using the open framework? That That's what he's doing. That's good anyway. All right. Okay. Exactly. To you, and you keep quiet. Okay.
These questions are fine. No questions are invalid. So this is perfect. This is exactly how architects work. If you don't do this, then you are not an architect. Now, ADM or in relation to any architecture framework, frameworks give us a structure to make those decisions. Decisions are still yours to make. Means you can say that I recommend this or this, and then let the stakeholder decide that based on these criteria, based on these five criteria, I recommend this particular change compared to this, and then stakeholders will decide, right? So ADM or in general TOGAF gives us a complete structure on making those decisions, and in a structured fashion, so that if you present it to somebody else also, they understand that you have done something valuable and now they can make a more informed decision.
That's the answer Ari was looking for, nothing else.
That is,
no.
That is
not yet.
I think, yeah, it's a not good yet. Question, okay. But slowly we'll get there. Now let us take another break and we'll come back in how much.
If we take a break, it's almost 2 o'clock.
You know, we're going to finish in 20 minutes. Do you need a break now? It's up to you.
Do you have anything lined up for today, Anshu? You want to go through it, or you had planned for ADM only for today? Then I think we can wind it up.
ADM
okay
will
that.
Come in every session. So if you have a hard stop, then we can stop at within 20 minutes. I was thinking that because we have taken the earlier break also, and even this break will be about say 15 minutes, so we will go for almost 45 minutes after this break, if you are okay.
Other
plans?
yeah.
Then we'll make it a point that we stop now. But maybe I have a request to you for tomorrow. So if you are ready to hear.
That's what I was about to ask you, but you are raising it. So now, how flexible are you with the timings? We have to look at your side because you are nearly from India. I don't know. That's what you are going to talk, I think, with the timing. Or
So 5:30 in the morning for me is too early.
Yeah, I was thinking about this. Yeah.
And early in the sense, I wake up
I
around
that
time. Even for US, it could be, the later time might become difficult. But I was thinking if we can do instead of your 10 a.m., 11 a.m. if it is possible, then that will help me.
Yeah, no problem with me because the Shahid and because you know I know I don't.
See, the thing is, on weekends I usually go with children. I watch TV and then I go to sleep by 3 a.m. or something, and then I can't wake up in the morning and attend 10 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
11 a.m.
See, I'm you know,
so is 11 okay for you?
Yeah, it is. 11
even 12 is okay for me, means for you, will be 12 p.m. afternoon, and mine will be like 7:30 a.m. in the morning. At that,
yeah, 12 is okay, man.
If you are taking it 12 o'clock, even that is fine because either I need time in the morning or in the evening. You know, because now if you talk about 2 o'clock, we just have 3 hours. 5 o'clock, everything closes here in Australia. So either 3 hours or you start at 12 o'clock. I don't have any problem. 12 to 4.
So
I'm
means,
fine with that.
Anshu, you will have 7:30 for your time.
Yeah, I'm writing on the screen also. If you are okay with this, let us do this from tomorrow. If you are all okay. So that will be 12 in the Australia time, right?
So it will take
12 Australian time. I think
12 to 4.
4 o'clock. So Anshu, you are okay with the other option you asked for 11? I don't know. I'm just, is it, does that suit you? Because
11 is also okay for me, but I think one of you were saying that you need either morning or
it will be from 2 at least. I was about to step out now and do some work
for
outside.
Today, but, it's okay. Today we will end.
Remember, Arif, I'm flexible with anything, but remember, Arif, when you say 12, you will go only till 4 o'clock. And if you have to do something, there is only a 1 hour window if you are sharp or anything. You will, you so have
that's
to
what, do, till morning, till 9, morning. 9 to 12, we have 9.
Okay, 10, no problem. 11. That's what it's used. Okay yes. with you. I don't have any problem.
I'm so this is more suitable for everyone. This first one here.
Shahid.
Yeah, 12 is okay with me, man. I mean, I'm happy.
The later okay. it is, okay. I mean, yeah, come on. I mean,
no problem. I have no problem. I'm flexible with anything.
Okay. We, I mean, so let
for you, we'll I think waking up at 5:30 is, I mean, come on.
No, waking up is not a problem. I wake up around 5:30, but then I have to take bath and I have to finish my breakfast before everything starts. So I need some time for all that.
Even if you would have not raised this, I was about to ask you. That's why when you are trying to ask the question, I asked you. I read your mind, you know. So maybe it is better if we give more time for you. And, you know, it's
good. If we are all comfortable, then we'll enjoy it more and then make more productive.
Should not be sleepy heads, or you know.
That's okay. That's fine.
All right.
So then we have 20 minutes more today. Now 15 more minutes. So then let us continue instead of taking the break. Let me still take a 5-minute break. Just I have to fill my bottle, water bottle. So if you want to take a restroom or a little break, come back in 5 minutes.
Okay. No worries.
Hello.
ADM क्या करता है कि भाई it will lay down the platform उसके ऊपर जो है हाँ वो पूरा SDLC नहीं SDLC part of your migration plan
हाँ मतलब वो वही process follow कर रहा है जहाँ पे as is business blueprint बोलते हैं ना वो भी तो
migration plan जो कौन सा ये है वो कौन सा डी और एफ एफ जो ये है वहां पे तुम्हारा इंडिविजुअल जो ये पूरा जो है एडीएफ जो है क्या है एडीएफ ये ना
एडीएम
मेथड जो है इट विल डिफाइन फ्रॉम द हाई लेवल ठीक है और एक एक फेस जो है ना अंदर अगेन इट विल हैव मल्टीपल फेसेस सब फेसेस For example, application and solution में कि भाई it will have its own phases और तुम्हारा जो F वाला जो है migration phase that is again will have a SDLC sub कि भाई prepare करो ये करो
DevOps
करो देखो हाँ DevOps है जो भी है that phase is
वो ठीक है मतलब वो तो है मेरा मोस्टली वो था चूजिंग दी एप्लीकेशन उस पे ज्यादा ये था
नहीं 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 वो तुम वो मत देखो दैट इज इफ यू गो दैट वे देन तुम्हारे को बेकार है वो मतलब यू नो इफ यू गो दैट वे तुम्हारे को यूज नहीं होएगा वो अगर अगर वो उसमें तुम जा रहे हो अगर उसमें वैसे देख रहे हो ना तो इट्स नॉट गोइंग टू हेल्प यू हमको हाई लेवल का चाहिए सिर्फ हम लोगों को एप्लीकेशन डिसाइड करना ये सब छोटी छोटी चीजें हैं ये यू नो कि भाई कौन सा एप्लीकेशन चाहिए अब देखो भाई फॉर्म्स है ठीक है हम लोगों का रिक्वायरमेंट था फॉर्म्स इसको चाहिए फॉर्म्स तो डिस्कस किया
तो चार लोगों ऊपर ऊपर डिस्कस कर लिए, हाँ भाई हम लोगों को यार फॉर्म्स कैसे में चाहिए, हाँ अरे यार कोई एक बोला रहेगा इसको कि भाई तुम लोग है ना शेयर पॉइंट में फॉर्म्स ये करो, तो बंदे लेके आ गए। अब वो फॉर्म्स लास्ट में क्या हुआ, SAP में आया हो, हम लोगों ने बोला कि भाई ये तो इसमें भी कर सकते हो तुम। तो डिसीशन जो है पहले वो लोग ले लेते हैं। अब वो IAS में क्यों जाना पड़ा, ASG को क्यों देना पड़ा ये लोग, ठीक है। द रीजन वाई दे गेव इट इज, एक तो तुम्हारा जो कॉस्ट है जहां पे तुम्हारे सर्वर जो रख रहे हो अभी, ठीक है, तुम सर्वर रख रहे हो तो बिल्डिंग का चार्ज चाहिए तुमको, ठीक है। और वो एक 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 फ्लोर पूरा था, फर्स्ट फ्लोर पूरा था अपना, ठीक है। एवरी मंथ यू पे द बिल फॉर द बिल्डिंग, इलेक्ट्रिसिटी, एयर कंडीशनिंग और तुम्हारा जो उसका सॉफ्टवेयर लाइसेंसिंग, एंड एवरी 3 years यू नीड टू चेंज द हार्डवेयर, ठीक है। तो ये सब कॉस्ट ये क्या करेगा, CIO वो सोचा होगा कि भाई वो जब रिपोर्ट देखता है कि भाई मेरा पैसा कहाँ जा रहा है, अरे यार इसमें ये मेंटेनेंस में तो इतना जा रहा है, तो सोल्यूशन देखेगा, गूगल करेगा हाउ टू रिड्यूस द कॉस्ट। ओके somebody, कोई भी भाई बिजनेस मॉडल ये है कि भाई तुम्हारा हार्डवेयर
exactly, देखो वहां वहां तक मतलब वो तो खैर वो तो अंडरस्टूड है। okay, मेरा जो पॉइंट आ रहा है कि चूजिंग जो है, ठीक है, अब नाउ अभी जो
प्लेटफॉर्म
का जो सुनो तुम क्वेश्चन सुन लो पहला। चूजिंग अभी तुमको SAP के बारे में मालूम है, इसके लिए तो यू कैन कॉन्फिडेंटली स्पीक अबाउट SAP, हाँ भाई SAP, SRM, HRA, success factors, tip of your fingers,
yeah, understand,
forget about SAP,
हाँ,
okay, SAP को निकाल दो, अभी, you know, being in defense, कितने applications आते हैं, ठीक है, अभी जैसे कि मतलब example आया था वो Asana, अब Asana को अगर मैं Google नहीं करता था तो मेरे को मालूम ही नहीं पड़ता था कि पहले जीरा और Confluence उसका replacement है जो already defense use कर रही है। That's how I explained her कि भाई तू क्यों इसके पीछे पड़ी हुई है। Again, have this.
Every time back.
No, अच्छा, Ranju, let him finish. I will talk. I think.
Sure. आप लोग सभी हिंदी भी बोलते हैं?
हाँ।
मैं आज सिर्फ एक हिदाया छोड़ के हिदाया नहीं बोलता।
Okay. ठीक है, तो if required, you can also ask things.
Hey, Anshu, don't speak in Hindi. No.
I am not. But if you are,
if it's going to become problem, I should drop out from the course then.
No, not for the course, but I am saying that sometimes questions come into your mind and language might become a barrier. So you can ask your questions in any of the languages if you prefer, and we can take it up.
So they can ask in Hindi, but you translate and tell, and then I can listen.
Yes,
I can understand, but I cannot speak. Is the problem? Yeah, but anyway, no problem.
Okay, perfect. So now let us go into the introduction to the course, because now you understand the reason for architecture. We have seen some examples from your work and one of my examples that we have learned a little. So let us figure out what is going to happen here. So there are two portions of TOGAF. If we are looking at from the TOGAF exam point of view, and even the book of TOGAF is organized in such a way that foundation means terminology and concepts of TOGAF. So all the ADM and everything will come in foundation. Second level is certified. This is an advanced level, which means application of the concepts. That's it. All right, from an exam perspective. So foundation and certified. So there are multiple levels. Somebody who is foundation certified can upgrade. So we'll not be worried about that part right now, because I think none of you are already certified in TOGAF any previous versions, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so foundation is terminology and certified is being able to analyze and apply to a certain situation. So now audience wise, we are okay. We are already in this, so we don't have to worry about who else is the audience. But anybody who is associated with architecture, so whether you are solution architect, technology architect, information architect, data architect, application architect, and sometimes names also vary. So sometimes you have a name of the role as solution architect, but you are actually doing many other architect roles. So it does happen in many organizations. So name wise, it's not directly related to what you are doing always. And let us keep going. This is certified. So in this training, we are going to do both foundation and certified. And as we go along, you will realize that foundation is required for the other level, which means analyzing and applying the knowledge. So as we get clear about terminology and different concepts of TOGAF, then you will be able to apply it in many places. Plus, you will be able to utilize it in your own organization. Now, when you have specific words in the terminology, it is mainly for us to understand that what we are doing. But remember that when we talk to the stakeholders in your organization or any other project outside also, we need to start speaking their language. So although we understand something as an artifact, but if the stakeholder understands it as a document, then you would want to call it as a document instead of artifact for the stake when you are at least speaking to the stakeholder. If you are just architect sitting somewhere and talking among yourselves, then it is okay to use the internal terminology. But for stakeholders, we have to remember that we should speak their language.
No, you're not touching that. Go and watch TV.
Is that a question?
Sorry, I was talking to my girl.
Oh, okay. All right. So now this is another part of the TOGAF exam. Exam goes in two manners. You can take either level one and level two separately, or there is a combined exam. And we will slowly realize that it just suits to your purpose whether you want to do level one and level two separately. I did my combined together, so that worked for me. This is about three hours exam, and level one and level two are split between 1.5 hours, things like that. So it just depends on your comfort level. Now, before we leave, I would like each of you to visit opengroup.org. And does any of you already have a login created in OpenGroup? If not, then go to opengroup.org right now and create a login. So you will have to say something like register or sign up, and I can show you on my screen if you would like that. opengroup.org. Do you see it on my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So on
can
the
I
top,
have one question see... before yes, you get into ahead. This? Yeah. When you said level one and level two, the level two is actually the practitioner. It's called as certified, or is this a level one and two is in foundation itself?
It's the name. So level 2 is the certified level. And so level 1 is the foundation level.
So that means level 2 means, is that not the practitioner? Because I'm thinking there is two levels. One is foundation and one is practitioner. Is not that, or is that the same terminology? Oh, in a...
you can call it as practitioner, but right. So in many other certifications, practitioner is a common term. But in TOGAF, essentially, once you are level 1 and level 2, that is when you are called as TOGAF certified advanced. It is called TOGAF 9 advanced certification. And this name keeps changing sometimes. So what was true 2 years ago may not be, may have changed.
All right,
but
no
yes,
problem.
Practitioner means you are able to apply the knowledge, and that is what level 2 prepares you for.
Okay.
All right. So if you go to Open Group website, click on login, and you should find a place to register. Yeah, create an account. So I have an account already, but you would click on create account. And then just go through that process. It is free. So then as we go along the course, I will show you a few places where you would want to go to the website and download few documents, few artifacts. There are amazing amount of useful documents lying here. Once we understand what's the use of them, then you would want to go to this website more often, I think. And as we go along the course, you will realize. So for today, just create your login whenever you find time, maybe right now or maybe sometime before we meet again tomorrow. All right, this looks easy. The Open Group sign up.
Just created my account.
Okay, perfect. And about this course, you don't have to be an architect before attending this course. It is useful, but it's not necessary, because this course makes you an architect. It prepares you as an architect also, in addition to preparing for the exam as well. So foundation training, you will, on my screen, you are going to notice that some of the chapters of the TOGAF documents, which we are going to go through, all of them during this training, those are mentioned.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Are you talking to us? Or on the phone?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, I think I'm losing. When will you finish that foundation course? How many days?
So it's like a split half, you can say. But I don't keep strict timelines in that sort, that when do we finish foundation versus certified, because as we understand the TOGAF's terminology, it is almost every time we meet that I will show you a few things of the first exam, and we will prepare for the second exam in parallel. So as we go along the course, it is foundation and certified both together. So you don't have to worry about it, but I will show you when it is becomes important, because when you start following the books which are given by the Open Group, then you will realize that they have split the content in multiple sections and parts, where to find the foundation material and where to find the certified material. So that is why it's useful to know. But from the training point of view, you don't have to worry.
Okay, but you know, in the meantime, when you're during the course and or during the weekdays, normally when we go through it, so the document, the PDF document, which is the whole you know, for the foundation as well as for the certification, do we have to go through that, or what documents do we have to
if
refer?
You do, it is useful, and I will see whenever we end the training, I will help you with what to do, yeah, either for tomorrow or for the whole coming week, depending on what is our gap. So the document that we have already, this document which I think you also have on your machines downloaded, so that is the one which we will use. And if you go through it during the week, as I recommended, even 10 minutes per day is fine, either revising what we have already done, or you can go through a little bit of futuristic further classes so that you can understand faster, because content wise there is a lot. TOGAF has a lot to understand, but lot does not mean it is difficult. It is easy as long as we discuss. All right, so introduction, then there is a management overview chapter, which means if you have to give an overview of what you are doing in the TOGAF course or training, or you have to describe to somebody in the management that what TOGAF is all about in general, even after this training. So this chapter is very useful in that sense, that it covers almost everything that TOGAF offers in a concise, quick manner. So that chapter is very useful. Then we start going into detail, TOGAF's components, which also belong to the parts of the book. Then we go through ADM in detail, and then there are a few new terms that you see here in this page, but they will become clear slowly. Right now we are just looking at the names of topics. So then architecture repository, enterprise continuum, governance for architecture, views and viewpoints. Views are usually diagrams which are created for stakeholders. Then building blocks. Building blocks are essentially the boxes, circles that you see. So any items which are required for either a process or a business or a diagram, all of those are building blocks. Then again, ADM phases in more detail. Guidelines and techniques. So for specific phases, there are a few techniques that are very useful when you are in that certain phase, like using a particular diagram or using a particular method. So this chapter describes all that. Then you have important deliverables, and by the time we reach this chapter, you would have known many deliverables by that time. So this chapter is dedicated to important deliverables of TOGAF. Then we have some reference models. So TOGAF gives some example models on certain domains of business, for example, technology. So when you are in a technology phase, it gives you a model to start working with instead of thinking of your own. And then TOGAF certification, we are already talking about it in many chapters. So in every chapter, at the end of it, we will go through a small quiz kind of thing, which will help you confirm the topics. Plus, we are always discussing things. So the quiz is based on the exam pattern. So you will get used to the exam patterns as well. Plus, as we move along in the further classes, like I think starting from fourth and fifth classes, we will start taking the exam papers also, the full proper papers which have actually appeared in TOGAF exams, along with our rest of the study. So it's like five questions at a time, and then we take a break, and then again study a new topic, then again take five more questions. So it's like whenever you are feeling sleepy, just tell me that. Then we can take few questions from paper so that you wake up and start thinking a little more. All right, so because this topic, if you are doing it alone, just at your home and not talking to anybody, these kind of topics may become boring or they may make you sleep. But when you are discussing and doing a lot of things, creating, sharing your stories, hearing somebody else's stories, then it becomes easy and we can go through this course very easily. And because this covers every aspect of a business, this will enable you to become an architect, obviously, plus you will be more comfortable thinking of as an owner of a company. So that gives you a very different feeling when you become an architect. So with that, let me just quickly go finish this chapter. The certified training also covers many of the foundation topics again with a different perspective. So you will see the same topics once more here, but then it goes phase by phase also. So every phase is a complete chapter by itself in the certified section of the TOGAF material. So we'll get there as we move along. And towards the end, there are a few advanced topics like security considerations, a few other relations, service-oriented architecture, maturity models. So we will look at all that as we go along. Then finally, skills framework, architecture skills framework. So from an upgrade point of view, we don't have to worry about it because none of us is upgrading for the exam. So open group, I think all of you know the website. Now, hopefully you will create your logins. Some of you have already done it. So that is useful. And we will meet tomorrow then. Unless you have questions right now before we break. Let us meet at your unknown.
Where is this PDF? You said we have already given. We have given this PDF, what you went through.
I was informed that this is shared with you. If not, then okay. So if not, then today's version, what we have done till today with the new pages that we have created, I will share it with your organizer, and he should be able to give it to you.
Yeah, if you could get that, that's good. Yeah.
And if possible, can you write your email IDs on the chat so that you need something to share quickly, then probably that would be easier for me also.
One second.
Copying from the chat. Let's see. Yeah, I'm trying to copy. Okay, yes, I got it. So Idayat's ID I got and Shahid.
Arif is on mute. Wait.
What happened?
Email ID. If possible.
Email ID?
Yes. Your Gmail, right?
Yeah, anything where you can receive documents if required. Whether Gmail, Yahoo,
rf17@gmail.com. अरे तुम आरिफ
ओके
भेजा ना.
Yeah, but yeah. I've also done. Yeah.
Okay, got it. All right, thank you everyone. And
thank you very much. It was really enjoyed, you know.
Sure, thank you everyone. That is what I have to make sure, that you have fun while we learn.
Yes. And yeah, I literally have.
Only then we will learn.
Thank you.
So All right, I'll see you tomorrow.
We'll meet tomorrow. 12th, right? Yeah. Our time.
Yes. So I will tell the modified time to the organizer so that they can schedule the meeting timing. And
7:30. We'll meet tomorrow. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yes. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good day. Bye bye.
Bye bye. Anshu?
Yes.
How about the record? Recording what you have done so far? Is it available tomorrow?
It should be. I will talk to the organizer. How soon will it be available to you?
Okay. Thank you very much. Cheers.
All right.
I'm closing this. Okay. Sir. Thanks. Bye. Yep.